welcome everyone to our second at Conroy Literary Center book club. Today, looking at The Water is Wide. Like any good book club, we're going to begin with a public shaming. How many of you have read the book before? That's a good sign. Anybody seen one or both of the movie versions as well? Also, nearly everybody. Excellent. Yes, that's a promising start, I would say. Better ratio than most book clubs have. The same question. Well, we're delighted today to have Mollie Barnes with us. Mollie is professor of English at USC Buford, where she specializes in 19th century, although that's not our subject tonight, obviously. And Mollie also, just to prove how overqualified she is to lead this book club conversation tonight, Mollie was the coordinator, one of the coordinators, for USCB's first year reading experience with this very book, Water is Wide, and she's going to talk a little bit about that experience, what it's like to teach this book right now, as well as Pat's own experiences as well. So everybody welcome Mollie, and we'll get started.
Thank you so much for having me. I feel very honored to get to come and be part of this book club, and totally overwhelmed by the prospect of trying to follow up John Morley last time, because that was delightful, of course. I am not a personal friend of Pat's, so I can't talk about funny stories and meaningful stories from college, but what I can talk about is my experiences being a student and being a teacher. Do I have any teachers in the book club?
Former.
Okay, so I figured there would be lots of teachers in this room, so I hope that we can bring our experiences to bear with this book. So we are going to talk about the 19th century for just a hot minute, because I will always talk about the 19th century when given an opportunity. I thought maybe in the spirit of Pat Conroy, who seems really good at getting his students off task to get them curious, I would start by being off task for a couple minutes to talk about one of my great loves, because my entry point to this book, I don't know, it seems a little weird, and only happened once I moved to the Low Country. So my access point, as Jonathan like kindly said, I was asked to develop a first year reading program at the University of South Carolina, Buford. That was not my idea at all. That was my friend and colleague Laura Besson's idea. She had wanted to do a first year reading program with students for a really long time. She thought that The Water is Wide would be the perfect book for us to start with. So that was the very first book that we did. And I can talk a little bit about first-year reading programs and our first-year reading program in particular, because I think that has a spirit that I think Pat would appreciate. But we are going to start with the 19th century. So I'm working on an article about a 19th century teacher, Charlotte Fortin. I don't know if some of y'all might know of Charlotte Fortin, if you've read Sue Monk Kidd's book. She talked about the Grimke sisters. Charlotte Fortin is a relative of the Grimkes. And so I'm working on a project about her. She was the first black teacher at the Penn School. And I've been working on an article about her lately, and how she figured teaching as an act of resistance, as a way to get political, and to learn how to become a better person through her students. And I've been doing that as I've been thinking about this book club. So I thought I would read some passages that Charlotte Fortin wrote in her journals when she was at the Penn Center 100 years before The Water is Wide is set, to kind of set the tone for today. And maybe we could think about some of the parallels between the way she talks about her students and what she wants to do with them, and the way that Pat talks about his students and The Water is Wide. So we're going to go on that tangent real quick. So this she wrote, I'll read just a couple entries, and then I promise we'll talk. This is an entry she wrote that made me think of the early passages in The Water is Wide, when Pat's talking about how he's young and feeling anxious, irritated with the world, and developing a sense of purpose. So in August, right before arriving from Philadelphia to the Penn Center, Charlotte Fortin wrote, this is August 17th, "It's my 25th birthday. It is an unpleasant thought that I have lived a quarter of a century and am so very, very ignorant. 10 years years ago I hoped for a different fate at 25, but why complain? The accomplishments, the society, the delights of travel, which I have dreamed of and have longed for all my life, I am now convinced can never be mine. If I can go to Port Royal, I will try to forget all these desires. I will pray that God in his goodness will make me noble enough to find my highest happiness in doing my duty. And that's teaching. So now I'll give you her first glimpses of the school, and then we'll delve into the waters wide. So she's talking about Laura Town, who's a little cranky, kind of like Mrs. Brown. and we went into the school and heard the children read and spell. The teachers tell us that they have made great improvement in a very short time, and I noticed with pleasure how bright, how eager to learn many of them seem. The singing delighted me most, and of course I was thinking about Pat Conroy's love of music with his students. They sang beautifully in their rich, sweet, clear tones, and with that peculiar swaying motion which I have noticed before in the older people, which seems to make their singing all the more effective. And I'll read one more little passage. This is one of my favorite parts, and it always gets me in the feels. This was November 10th, so she'd only been at the school about a month. And she's talking about teaching the students John Brown's Body, the song about the radical abolitionist. So here she says, we taught, or rather commenced teaching. I mean, like, I think about all the times I try to get fired at school. Like, this is like she's not even been teaching for 2 weeks. She's trying to get fired. We taught, or rather commenced teaching the children John Brown when they first entered eagerly. I felt the full significance of that song being sung here in South Carolina by little black children, by those whom he, the glorious old man, died to save. Miss Laura Town told them about him. Was there ever a lovelier road than that through the part of my, up the way that my school lies? I wish you were here to go with me. It is lined with woods on both sides. On one tall, stately pines, on the other, the noble oaks with their graceful moss drapery, and the road is captured with those brown, odorous pine leaves that I love so well. It's perfectly lovely. I forgot that I was almost ill today while sauntering along, listening to the birds and breathing the soft, delicious air. At the last part of the walk, through sun and sand, the less said, the better. I talked to the children a little today about the noble Toussaint. They listened very attentively. It is well that they should know that one of their own color could do for his race. I long to inspire them with courage and ambition of a noble sort and a high purpose. So I'll leave you with that, because in 1863, 1864, there was another teacher teaching students about the nobility of the place that they come from. So let us start with the book that we actually are here to talk about today, The Water is Wide. I brought for y'all the handouts because I don't know how to do a discussion without a handout. Some materials that I prepared when I did the first year reading program. And I'll just tell you a little bit about those and then a little bit about the program, and we can kind of take this wherever y'all want to take this. So I gave you, again, I hope kind of in the spirit of Pat Conroy, on the first page is the prompt that our committee wrote to get students to talk about the book, to write about the book. So this is a piece of paper that's written for students. The rest of the pages, and I'm not going to read them at you, I promise, the whole time, is the guide that I wrote for teachers to teach the book. So you can see I have got a couple pages on how to lead a discussion, and then the parts that we might find kind of interesting to play with tonight, depending on y'all's interest, are quotations that we picked out from the book, and we wrote some questions for students to engage in. This was the very first time that we had a first-year reading program at USCB. This was in the fall of 2016. I can get into this or not. These programs are sort of controversial.
Did you say that they are?
Yeah. Yeah, okay, so a first year, they're sometimes called common reads. So every incoming first year student receives a copy of the book. At our school, we were fortunate to have the funding from the Academic Affairs Office that gave the book to the students. I did a first year. and then every student in the class reads the book together. And the idea of these programs is that it's a common thing, binding the students together. It's a common intellectual experience that they get to share. And it's the first thing that they share in common once they arrive in a new place. And given the demographics of our school, it's really cool because we have a lot of students who are from this region, from Beaufort or Jasper County. Some of them have never read a book cover to cover in their lives before they come to college. So if they read the book, it's the, maybe the first book that they've read cover to cover. And the idea is that the university community sort of develops different kinds of programming around the book so that everybody gets involved, and it's a way of kind of like welcoming the students. This is a complicated thing to do, of course. People have all kinds of different philosophies about it. In my heart of hearts, I think it should be something everybody does, and it's not. There's not a test or a quiz about it. People do it because reading books is a good thing to do. And this is one of the ways we teach people to love books. There are some universities where people fold that into the curriculum. The choice of books can get really political, though. And right before we had decided to do this at our school, there was a big brouhaha at another school in South Carolina that I'm not going to talk about because we're filming. But about the choice of books. And so what we kind of decided at USCB, while I'm no longer part of that project, so kind of moved on to some other things, was that we wanted the program to have a kind of social justice element. So this was the first book that we did. The second year, they read Hidden Figures by Margot Shetterly. The movie Hidden Figures had just come out. And then the last year, we did In the Country We Love, about immigration, by Diane Guerrero. So this really set the tone. So I thought maybe we could start with the section that I had given y'all on the prompt, the quotation, one of my favorite parts. I got to go and meet all the freshmen at the weekly orientation sessions and talk about the book over the summer before the freshmen were coming. So this was like, in some cases, the first opportunity that they had to talk to a professor. And I read, this is the passage that I read to them and to their families when they would come, and then we asked them to write about it. So I'll read it, and then maybe we can talk about it together, because this is like, as a teacher, one of my greatest fears is what happened. So here's what we read. At orientation, we introduced you to the common reading with a passage about a moment when Pat Conroy's students are writing. Conroy's essay prompt, this is his very first day in the classroom. This is on page 27 if you have the paperback. Conroy's essay prompt proves to be trickier than he expected for everybody. He remembers that he, quote, asked the kids to write a paper briefly describing themselves, telling me everything about themselves that they felt was important, what they liked about themselves, and what they didn't like. In some ways, the rest of the book traces Conroy's response to watching his students work on their papers. And this is a part that, for the teachers in the room, like gets you in the gut. He writes, by not being able to tell me anything about themselves, they were telling me everything. As the year rolls on, he realizes that these students do have many stories to tell. Part of what Mr. Conrad has to learn is not just how to teach his students to tell their stories, but also, importantly, how to listen. His snap decision to ask his students to put pen to paper that first day shapes many more choices than he makes about his first few weeks and months. So I thought I would just turn this over to y'all. What do you make of that moment in the book when he asks the students to write? And he says that he realizes that they were telling him everything.
I wondered if they knew how to write. That was what I thought.
Yeah, and express themselves. Things happen, but how do you express it?
Yeah.
Express your feelings.
which is a hard and vulnerable thing to do when you don't know the person in the front of the room who's asking you to do it.
Mm-hmm. It's a big ask for a teacher, really big ask.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me your strengths and weaknesses.
Yeah.
Like, who the hell do you think you are?
Let's talk about that a little bit, because I think he's setting himself up here in important ways for the kind of teacher that he is when he walks in that first day. And the kind of, what do y'all think about that?
Well, there were such different ages, first of all. Huge differences in ages. So what a kid might say is what color their hair is or something like that.
Yeah.
Probably nobody had ever asked them before.
Yeah.
And would there be consequences if they said something that you didn't want to hear?
Yeah. Do you think that he was, do you think he thought about that beforehand? Do you think he expected that?
No.
No.
he just, I mean, to me, that just showed how naive he was going over there. That's not criticism. I think anybody would have been that way. And when I read that passage, it was just stupefying.
Yeah.
I mean, can you imagine you signed up for this job, you had all this hope, you wanted to be in the Peace Corps, you were going to go out and change the world, and you get there. And these kids can't even put pen to paper.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh my God, what did I just sign up for? I mean, I just my mouth dropped when I read that. I had not read this book prior to getting prepared for the class and for the session.
Uh-huh.
And I've read many of his others, but never this one. And I just went, ooh, wow.
Did your jaw drop for him or for the students?
For both.
Okay.
I mean, I taught in rural Virginia my first year. And they gave me, I was the reading teacher.
Yeah.
And what that meant was that I was only part-time, and I had three periods of every child nobody else wanted. At the time, the terminology was educable, mentally retarded, emotionally disturbed, and learning disabled.
Yeah.
And so I remember that feeling of, oh my God, I'm not equipped to deal with these kids. I thought I was really going to teach reading.
Yeah.
And really, I was just there as a placeholder. And so I really related at that moment to how he must have felt when those kids couldn't do anything.
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, I felt it.
The first day of school is, I think, scary for students and for teachers. Really scary. I mean, I still get the major butterflies, and I think the day I don't is the day I need to probably quit. Well, okay, so it sounds like some of y'all were thinking that it's an odd, maybe surprising moment. It's one of the first moments that we actually, he dramatizes it, of course. I mean, we know this is Conroy, right? So he dramatizes it. Like, what purpose does that serve for us to see him, I think, flop as much as the students in this, like, opening moment of teaching? Because that's a really vulnerable thing. I mean, like, if my friends asked me at work, like, how'd your first day of class go? Even if it was horrendous, people vomited and cried, I would still be like, it was fine. It was totally fine. I don't know if I'm right about it.
Well, I think he thought he was going to come over there and just be, you know, God's gift to mankind, bringing these children, helping them. Again, you know, he wanted to be in the Peace Corps and make a difference. And he had no concept of how hard it was really going to be.
Yeah. So maybe it's like a moment of him learning something about the difficulties and the vulnerabilities of being part of education.
Mm-hmm. He was the first white teacher and the first male teacher, probably.
Yeah.
So the children were in shock.
Yeah.
So it was like a mutual two-way street there.
Yeah. And for the teachers in the room, I think that's a really important moment when you realize that you're being seen and studied just as hard as you're seeing and studying your students. There's kind of a parallel moment. I have it typed out for us. I think this is passage number 4. This is one of my favorite parts. So, yeah, so if you go to like page 5 or 6, this is like, he's sort of pan panicking, and as a teacher, this happens, like, on a daily, if not hourly basis for me, that, like, the thing that you should plan is, like, not working. It's not working, so you're going to have to come up with something else, and he decides to ask the students to draw. So I thought maybe I'll read this, and then we could talk about kind of how that pulls on what y'all are saying. They drew a picture of themselves. Y'all see where I am? Mm-hmm. This is on page 29 and 30 of the paperback. I had no particular reason for doing this. The thought impulsively struck me that it might be interesting to compare the drawings they made of themselves with the ones they made of me. I was very glad I did this when I saw the results. Most of the boys drew themselves to look exactly as they had drawn me. Several boys had made what looked like duplicate copies. The girls saved themselves from exact reproduction by the fact that they had included long hair and dresses in their self-portraits. No one had darkened his face or given any indication that he or she might be black. So I'll give you all the question that we gave the students, and then we can take it wherever y'all want. So here's what we asked the students. What does Conroy learn or think he has learned from seeing his students' self-portraits? How does he see his students differently from the ways that they see themselves? What does this passage tell us about the ways that Conroy's students see him, at least at first? And how might we use this passage to think about the ways we are perceived by other people or the other way around? So, I don't know. We could talk about those answers to the questions, or your answers to those questions, or how we might think about them differently than people who are 18. What do y'all think?
I think we're a little old for that.
Yeah.
Been there, done that.
Yeah.
I mean, in terms of perception.
I don't know.
I'm just speaking for myself.
Yeah.
Yes, I am. Generally speaking, that a lot of assumptions are made that people do of human condition, making assumptions. And I believe that Pat probably had some assumptions going in there, as did the Board of Education. And, and being in my whole career was in education, including that executive leadership, and it pained me greatly to read how the board reacted to all of this. It pained me. But to go back to this piece, the children obviously had not learned how to self-identify.
Yeah.
There was no who are you? What? How have you been growing in your environment and to make who you are?
Yeah.
I don't think that was quite evident at all with the children, let alone being able to put paper to pencil. And I do believe that they were used to being told what to do. And so this was a guy that comes in with a refreshing mind and change of heart to bring his children forward. That's how I saw that particular piece. And of course the drawings would be exactly the same.
Yeah.
First for acceptance, and second of all because they didn't know who they were.
Yeah.
And they wanted to aspire.
Yeah.
I wondered if they had mirrors. So maybe they had never seen themselves before.
I guess I'm struck thinking it's a little strange that, are we all Caucasians? That we would ask black kids to blacken their faces.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the perception of color when you draw a picture, I don't know if that's... I tutor at Ladies Island Elementary, and I've got 3 African-American kids and 1 Hispanic kid, and I see pictures, you know, in the hallway all the time of each other, and there's rarely pigmentation, or it's just done sort of all the same. Mm-hmm. It's not a part of the identity.
Yeah. Young children will make their selves orange faces. And blue faces.
Right.
Because of their color that they're into that week.
Yeah.
Right.
I wonder the crayons of that.
Well, the passage is sort of feels traumatic and profound and also really sweet then. themselves, and the maybe assumptions that he was bringing to the table, and also like his own. Like, I think that this is, seems to me like a pivotal moment of kind of like pausing in the book. That sort of, that so much of the rest of his interactions seem to kind of like unfold from this moment when he sort of pauses and realizes, I think, this thing of like, oh, I thought this was an elephant in the room, but that seems to not be something that they're representing the way that I thought they represented, right? Or that maybe they felt disempowered to even represent themselves, and so that there was an expectation of a right answer, which, if you were hanging out with Mrs. Brown for any amount of time, I mean, it's a fairly, it makes fairly good sense.
I have a question. I can't remember now, did he teach someplace else before he went to the bus? It seems to me he did.
Yeah.
And he taught high school, wasn't it? Okay, so his experience had been being in college, teaching high school, and then he goes to young children. He has no way to read. He has no experience whatsoever with that age group.
Yes.
He's just thinking about his professors and what his high school teachers, how they taught. And these kids were much younger.
Yeah.
Much.
I think that's important. I mean, like,
it's huge.
Yeah, what do y'all think about that? I teach 18-year-old people. If I got put in a room of, like, 11-year-olds, like, Lord help us. I mean, I would need some sort of major filter that I don't have. But like, I don't think I would know what to do. Like, those are, people are so different. I mean, that
would these mostly have forgotten, too. They were like what we'd call middle school range.
Yeah.
They were.
Yeah. People who are, how old are fourth graders?
9, 10.
But there were two that graduated, so they went all the way up.
Yeah.
It went all the
way. Well, they graduated to go to 9th grade at the high school.
Yeah.
They graduated from 8th grade.
Oh.
Yeah. To go to the main, because remember they went to live with him.
That's right.
The Marion. Yeah. I can't remember the...
TC,
that's right. Yeah.
I think one of the times he was most shocked was when Mrs. Brown told him that he had two really high-achieving students in the room. And gave them an assignment and they could barely read or write. And also that the children didn't understand him, he didn't understand them as well with the language barrier.
Yeah. That's a lot. I mean, which is also why that drawing seems like so wise and improvisational on some levels, but also then I can see why this would be kind of scary or, I don't know, it would give him pause in that moment, that even that is the response.
He probably thought that's something they all could do.
That's right.
It's not academic.
Mm-hmm. But to ask a 9-year-old to do that, and the difference between what how a 9-year-old might respond and a 14 or 15-year-old is also, like, when I think about how difficult that room must have been, even if it was not on Defusky, like, that's a tall order for a teacher. It's a really tall order.
And some kids don't think they're good at art, let's say.
Yeah.
So they're afraid to put something, and those teachers prior were so strict.
Yeah.
I think they were afraid to do anything.
Yeah. Well, we see him already trying to teach creativity, which is a really hard thing to teach people to do. I mean, I don't know if that's what he was thinking in the moment, but we see him trying to impart that joy to his students throughout those early chapters when he's playing music for them. This is a creative exercise, and for people who've been told over and over and over and over again, like, you need to follow the rules or I'm going to smack you with a stick or whatever.
Well, not even that. Mrs. Brown told them they're all slow.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, she constantly put those kids down.
Yeah.
She told them that.
Yeah. She told the kids to their face. You know, you're slow and some of you are stupider than others.
Yeah.
That had to be very demoralizing for those children. I mean, they didn't know any different.
And how do we know that again? I mean, I remember it from the book, but how do we know that Mrs. Brown said that to kids?
Well, it's the first day of class and brought her students in with his students and did an introduction speech. And
even that, because we're being kind of hard on him for that first exercise of write an essay about everything that you do. Draw a portrait of yourself. Draw a portrait of me. Like, think about the wild difference between that kind of introduction to students and what that asks of people. You know, what that asks of them in terms of their vulnerabilities and an assembly where you're being screamed at before you've even, like, really been there at all. Like, there's a kind of, like, bravery in what he's trying to do that those first couple of days.
I don't think he knew what he was doing. Mm-hmm. I say that as a former teacher, having taught a number of subjects. You don't know your class, mm-hmm. right? You have no idea what you're getting. And a lot of times the curriculum is so mm-hmm. impressive, but not right mm-hmm. for the kids you're mm-hmm. teaching at all. It doesn't fit at all.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he was in the same position a lot of teachers are, no matter mm-hmm. where they are.
Mm-hmm.
Because a curriculum is made for it to sound good mm-hmm. for school boards. Really, it really mm-hmm. is. And the kids are not prepared for that curriculum at all sometimes, mm-hmm. no matter where you are.
That's right.
I think he was just hoping to find, he was trying really hard to do something good for those children.
Yeah.
I thought.
Yeah.
Throughout the book.
Yeah. And to connect with them, like as human beings.
And those kids knew a lot.
Yeah.
But it was mostly stuff we don't know.
Yeah.
About the island and
yeah.
how to survive on the island. They knew
yeah.
a lot.
Well, that could be a good kind of direction for us to move in, is what does Pat start learning from his students then? Because that seems to take up a lot of the space in subsequent chapters. For like I think the whole middle and ending of the book is how Pat gets schooled onto Fusky. So what does he learn from these students? Right then and there, that would never have happened. And that seems to me like the least of his concerns, of all the concerns that he has, of the rules that he's breaking. But it is, and it's like an entire chapter is devoted to this, really. Like, that is the centerpiece of that book, that the entire vignette. I heard some, like, hard nods when she started talking about the animals. Does other people have things to say about
Excuse
that part?
Me, I just want to... Look back at me. Back is killing
yeah,
me.
Yeah, I would
can't
do
sit this way.
I would do a circle.
Yeah.
Do a circle.
We'll do a circle.
Yeah. And he comes back to the animals too a couple of times. Were there other things that you think he started taking from his students, like learning from them?
He already didn't know those age groups and how could he have? Really, how could he have? To me, it has a lot to do with those children's backgrounds, but I think it would be any class that was that age group mix,
mm-hmm.
almost anywhere. I felt so sorry for him.
Mm-hmm.
But he was just trying to be good to them,
mm-hmm.
number one, and then trying to find something
mm-hmm.
that they could latch on to.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't matter the curriculum, because that wasn't going to matter anyway. He realized that really early on.
Right.
I thought it was marvelous.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And they began to trust him.
Mm-hmm.
And that was huge for them. he must have known he liked me.
Yeah.
And that had to be enormous to have a teacher like them and treat them like somebody important. Probably one of the best things he did for me.
Yeah. That's a hard thing to gain the trust of students. Do y'all think there was a moment when it seemed to happen for the class as a whole or for the individual students that he has?
It seemed like the DC trip was a real biggie.
Yeah.
As far as game, not just the students, but the parents as
well. Yeah, yeah. Or the Halloween.
Yeah, another good one.
The Halloween trip was like that too.
You wanted to show them fun. Education is fun.
Yeah.
And learn about their culture and they learn about his culture.
Yeah.
And yet he didn't pick up on how deeply they were afraid of the spirits.
Yeah.
And how much that was part of their upbringing and their culture until later.
Valentine's Day.
Yeah, because it was fun.
Yeah.
When they went. It was a great, great moment that weekend that they went to Beaufort or Port Royal to trick or treat. And then it came back around again.
Yeah.
And he didn't realize that.
Yeah. And that is a whole body of knowledge that they teach him, too. I think ghosts and witches. But when we talk about the joy that he tries to impart to them and their education, I mean, like, the Wizard of Oz moment, right? Or, like, when he has them all chanting with the maps. I mean, like, I don't think there's any greater moment than when you get in trouble as a teacher because your class is being too loud, right? Like, that is a badge of honor when everybody is just laughing too hard, right? But that's what they should be doing. But that's a hard kind of trust to earn, for sure.
I think, too, when he went to, was it Miss Edna, to try and talk her into letting him go for Halloween, just, they love you, Mr. Conrad.
Yeah.
And, I mean, so you knew that these kids were going home at night,
and
he really was making a difference to them, that they were yapping about him, you know, the whole time. And I was really surprised at how the community embraced him after that moment.
Yeah.
You know, because they certainly stood behind him through everything that was going on. Once he won them over with that Halloween trip.
Which is a big ask, to say, like, let's all get on a boat.
Huge.
Because they couldn't swim.
But realizing that the kids are talking about him at home, I mean, that they're bringing him and what they share into their home lives. Yeah, that's a big thing.
Well, it seemed like they had the teachers they had had, and with this ground that they had more corporal punishment and ruled by fear and humiliation. And I think when the kids realized that he could talk like they could talk, and they weren't going within restraint, but he was able to connect with them, and then when he found out they weren't going to be getting a strap, and he didn't have a strap and wasn't going to get a strap, then they started trusting.
Yeah.
Well, and you look at how he even spoke to them,
okay?
I mean, today a teacher wouldn't really interact with their students in that fashion, but he spoke to them the way they spoke to him.
Yeah.
And was able to establish a dialogue with them in that fashion.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that really helped them trust him.
Yeah.
You know, because he was one of them at that point.
Yeah. There's another part. It comes right at the end of the DC trip. It's like one of the last quotations, I think on the second to the last page, that might kind of get at some of the stuff that y'all are talking about. I guess this is kind of a question, whether the kids are aware of the fact that Pat's taking them in, that Mr. Conrack is trying to take them in as much as they're trying to take him in. So they're riding in the car, I can't remember if this is on the way to Washington. So this is quotation 11. It's difficult to calculate the value of an experience I never created a test to evaluate the trip. That's Miss Brown would do that. Nor did the thought ever occur to me. On the way to Washington, it struck me that the trip was a good thing in itself and needed no defense. Barbara and I were riding in the front seat of the station wagon not far outside Beaufort when Jasper leaned up and asked me, "What are those old lines for?" "What old lines?" I asked. "Those old lines all over the road." I still didn't know what he was talking about. "I don't see any lines on the road, Jasper." "Yeah, they're all over the road," he answered. Then Barbara said, "You mean the lines that divide the highway, Jasper? They tell the driver which side of the road to stay on. The yellow lines tell the driver if he can pass another car or not." "Oh," said Jasper. I sat there trying to comprehend what had just happened. I had seen the lines so often that they disappeared from sight and were no longer part of my consciousness. To Jasper, who was accustomed to unpaved roads, they represented something strange, unexplained, and beyond his framework of experience. For the rest of the trip, Barbara and I decoded road signs, billboards, and numbers painted on bridges and overpasses, things I had not noticed for 10 years now, assumed great significance. I regretted that I could not be making this trip with the freshness of insight and beautiful innocence of Jasper and the others. I regretted that I was old, that I could no longer appreciate the education afforded by an American highway, and that I could not grasp the mystery of a single line painted down a road going north. I love that part. I think there's a lot there. Unpack it for me.
Well, I guess, when you were saying what did Pat learn from the kids, I mean, it's been a while since I've read the book, but I don't think in terms of specific things, of cooking or spirits or all of that. I mean, I see it as a part of his progression in life. I mean, he also wrote the book as a young man. So he was pretty hubristic, I think. I mean, as a lot of us are going into teaching or other first-time experiences as whatever he was, 25 years old. And that's a part of what he got out of this experience, is just learning, or starting to see what an ego can do in terms of making you blind to. And I think that was a lifelong experience for him, as it is for most of us, if we're lucky.
Yeah, if we're lucky.
Yeah. We're all limited by our own experiences, and the younger we are, the fewer experiences we have. So we have to put everybody's like that.
Yeah.
And he was too.
Yeah.
But the fact that Jasper could ask that question, that is huge. He felt the freedom to ask it.
Yeah. I was going to say, I think that's I wonder if Jasper would have asked that question at the beginning of the year. I mean, Jasper wouldn't have been on the road at the beginning of the year, but if Jasper would have felt safe asking that question, or I think Jasper probably always had the curiosity, but if he would have had the strength to express that curiosity.
That's a great word, safe.
Yeah.
That's what he made them feel safe, so they could learn. They could question and ask and ask and ask.
Yeah.
That these children needed to see the world.
Yeah.
Because to see the world would then bring them fully alive, in their experience of life.
Yeah.
And so he had that, which is why he was doing all of,
all of the avant-garde things
yeah.
that you wouldn't typically see, particularly in the, the 60s.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, because we were still pretty much in the Industrial Revolution in the 60s. And we all remember we all sat in rows
yeah.
in the classroom, and he just broke that right out.
Yeah.
It was like an explosion.
Yeah.
That would really be neat to see in classrooms today. And we do. I think there are. Sometimes we see that, but that was
pretty outstanding. It's also unique because these students have never seen anything else but what each of the others had seen, which was just that island. They had, most classroom children, some people went on vacations to Florida, mm-hmm. but these children all had the same experience, and it was limited. Mm-hmm. They didn't know anything else.
Mm-hmm.
So he had a pretty, like you said, mm-hmm. clean slate, mm-hmm. but a slate without a lot of background knowledge. And
mm-hmm.
background knowledge makes it easier to be creative and write and,
mm-hmm.
Understand things.
And it was interesting.
All they knew was what they
yeah.
had.
Mm-hmm. And it was interesting what he chose to teach them.
Yeah.
Wasn't it?
Yeah.
The topics that he thought were important for them so that they could build that momentum to just, get on out there
yeah.
and use that rather than whatever the curriculum was.
Yeah.
So,
like what they listen to on the radio is a good place to
yeah.
start.
Yeah.
Like that's a fine thing to do. Well, and I think he seems very aware here that he is opening their eyes to some things. But I think it's a very brave thing when he makes it clear that he doesn't understand what Jasper's talking about, too. As a teacher, when I betray to my students that I'm like, what is happening here? Like, I don't understand. You guys are having a conversation, and I am not in the circle. Like, what is going on? That's a brave moment to have with your students as well, because you're communicating that you don't share their language, right? Or that you don't share their worldview. So, like, what is it that Jasper's giving him in the question that he asks?
I was impressed with his wife.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't make fun of the way she what she thought she knew.
Mm-hmm.
She just matter of factly
mm-hmm.
said it.
Mm-hmm.
Again, the safety
mm-hmm.
to ask the question.
Yeah.
Jasper was showing me vulnerability.
Mm-hmm.
And when you have vulnerability, when you're able to show your vulnerability, it's a lot of courage.
Yeah.
That really equals courage.
And for a student to do that first, before a teacher, often when we're the teachers in the room, we have to be the ones who do that first to make. And he does at other moments. But here, Jasper's vulnerable. Jasper asks something, maybe he doesn't even know that that's a question that could be embarrassing to ask. But when he asks that, part of what he offers Pat is like this whole world, of like dazzling ways of looking at things that he's forgotten how to see, which is, I think for people who love education, like that's why we hang with these people. They teach us how to see the world every day with fresh eyes, with curiosity. And Jasper, he's taught that to the students at many moments along the road up until this point, but here, it seems to me that Jasper, perhaps unwittingly, gives it back to him. And the whole drive, imagine driving up to Washington, D.C., noticing things that you had forgotten that you needed to notice. That's also huge.
What a wonderful moment for future novelist Pat Conroy to relearn the importance of recognizing details
yeah.
and seeing the world through other people's eyes.
Yeah.
Which is the whole arc of the rest of his writing life
yeah.
as well.
Yeah. Even the lines, it seems like very metaphorical that he's talking about, like, staying within the lines. I'm sure that this moment really happened. But it's a very, meta writerly moment for him to be getting at that. And all of the questions of power that staying within the lines or transcending lines really raises.
And as the future writer, when you read his description, it's almost like you're thinking, oh my gosh, that was a marsh. Really. And then you begin to take a look at it,
Yeah.
in a different light as well.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
Are there other parts that y'all want to look at or questions that the book raises that we haven't touched on?
The fact that he used the word mute about those things as, I don't know, how old was he when he wrote the book? Mid-20s?
25.
I doubt he would have described as a 65-year-old man the ocean being mute. Or the, I mean, that's a young thing to say as a description. These things were not mute. And in his later life, he talked a lot about the sounds and the world. I mean, does that make sense?
Just one word to describe
him. Right, mute. Yeah.
He always said that he would never use just one adjective.
But the way he's thinking about the landscape or the waterscape to talk about the recesses of the human mind, like that seems like a theme that definitely gets played out, obviously, in so many texts. Like that's a very interesting way to think about the experience that he's having there. The island thing. Do you think that he's less lonely by the end? I mean, obviously he's not living on the island. Do you think he contends with loneliness in a different way, maybe?
I don't know that he would have been, because he was going home every night, you know? So he was, I don't think that would have entered into what was going on with him. Was coming across in the morning, spending the day with the kids, and then going home to Barbara at night. So I think he was pretty full of people and things to do. I know we talked about the importance of the Halloween trip to the kids, but I was taken with how important it had been to him. I have the hardback, so I can't tell you where I'm at. It's page 161 in the hardback, where he talks about the fact that slavery was still a reality, considering that none of my students grew up in homes with books where books flourished, where ideas fluttered and theories dwelt comfortably at dinner table discussions. And then he goes on to talk about, you know, how could I compare or relate my childhood to growing up there?
Yeah.
And then, you know, he comes to the realization, he says, if I let my students leave me without altering the conditions of their existence substantially, I knew a concrete, sightless ghetto of some city without hope would devour them quickly, irretrievably, and hopelessly.
Yeah.
And he resolves from that moment forward to do whatever it takes to show these kids the world.
Yeah.
I mean, not just by rote with the map, but show them the world.
Yeah.
And I thought that was a real turning point in his teaching philosophy and how he was going to approach that job at that point.
But I wonder actually if that's very much connected to the question that you raised about the island. Thing, because by the end, I wonder ideologically if he does feel somewhat alone or somewhat separate from the institutions that he has to participate in because of what he learns.
colleagues of his, I think he maybe felt more embraced by what teaching should be. Mm-hmm. You know, because he talks about bad teachers, how he hates bad teachers and whatever. But it was the administration, the hierarchy, that he knew he could never fit into and be part of.
Well, and I think part of too. I mean, I think he sees that. I think it's part of that passage that you were reading as a serious consequence of the period of Reconstruction. I mean, that Charlotte Fortin is talking about in those passages that I was reading at the beginning. I think he sees that as the unfortunate legacy. Those last chapters give me a stomachache every time I read them. I've got a happy place for us to land, but the quote that I'll just read it from the paperback. We talked about the ways that he dramatizes his mistakes or his difficult moments or his vulnerabilities. The ending feels there's an unquestionable note of humility, I think. At the very end, let's see. The last paragraph reads, "Of the Yamakura children, I can say little. I don't think I changed the quality of their lives significantly or altered the inexorable fact that they were imprisoned by the very circumstances of their birth. I felt much beauty in my year with them. It hurt very badly to leave them. For them, I leave a single prayer, that the river is good to them in the crossing." What do y'all make of that?
I think it's one of the saddest passages.
Why do you think it's sad, Sandra?
It just breaks my heart. You know, it's great because I think he's maybe seeing how I think he had a huge, much more of an impact on him than he realized. Certainly some of his students have said that. But I'm not sure he realized it then, and he felt like he really failed him by not, you know. I've heard him say, Jonathan, I always say Jonathan's my Google for bad information, but didn't he, do you agree with that, that he really felt like he was a failure in a lot of ways there because he couldn't change the system?
There's a passage earlier in the book where he says teaching is a series of failures. And, you know, I'm paraphrasing. He says it more better than that. But, you know, I think he was keenly aware that, you know, he didn't get to do everything he set out to do, that no one could have, but he did the best he can. And you know, how often do people come in here and give us a sort of where are they now question, what happened to those students? And so many of them had wonderful experiences, and they credit Pat for that. Not just from DeFusky, but from his 2 years at Buford High School as well. So regardless of Pat's own perception of himself as a teacher, from the student's perspective, he was remarkable.
Mm-hmm. But isn't that kind of the situation? I mean, with the teachers, I would ask, you always find out later the impact you've made on someone. I mean, you don't end a school year and really be able to, I mean, if you do, I suppose you can say success, you know, and have discrete metrics. But it's 10 or 20 or 50 years later when somebody stops you in the Publix and says, I can't believe the impact you made on my life, and then shares that. So, I mean, that's a part of the joy of teaching. There's a deferred joy or sense of impact.
Well, I think he felt like
conduct unbecoming a professional educator. That's a tough one to get past.
An educator, yeah.
Yes, that's tough to get past.
And I think as important for teachers, and I hope for students, as it probably did when the book came out in 72. And it was a question that we had wanted our students to sort of take up, and that was actually a question that I found was more interesting to the faculty maybe than to the students. But I think that I find it so interesting that that's where you kind of took your interpretation of that last paragraph, because I think if there is hope, it's that a memoir like this can be prompting uncomfortable conversations that are really urgent and really important for the sanctity of education if we take our work seriously in making students citizens who know how to treat one another and take that, you know, dearly to their heart. Not can they identify different countries on a map. That's part of it, but maybe it doesn't stop.
Education is like most fields that we have. I mean, you're going to have some people who stay on the lines and some people who don't. And that's just a part of keeping systems vital, I think. Sure, you can stay on the lines and you can continue the next year and then the next year after that. But I don't know. It takes a village, all sorts of people to have an impact. Spoken to somebody who was fired after 1 year of teaching. And then joined the Peace Corps, where I had a disastrous experience.
had, so we decided, one of the things that we wanted to do with the most important programs were, we called them fireside chats. So they were like little mini discussion groups. 199 students came. Yeah. The first event was Ellen Malfrey spoke at convocation and brought Bernie as a surprise guest. So, like, I think if there's going to be inappropriate language, that might have been the occasion with inappropriate language, was having Bernie in an auditorium with a microphone.
She got him off the stage pretty quickly.
She very quickly. Like, she was holding his person the whole time.
Like, I don't even think he got to say a word.
I don't think he did. Let the record state. Yeah.
Sorry, Bernie.
I think, in fact, one of the surprising things was I don't know if all of the students or even many of the students fully recognized what was potentially so provocative about the book, because in many ways I think they identified maybe more with the students than they did with him. Which was something that we really should have thought about a lot more when we assigned the book and didn't. And I think that makes it a different read if you're reading it through the students' eyes and not, I mean, even as you're saying, like, the narrative lapse between when the events happen and when the book is written is short. You know, it's still a young man reflecting on this experience, which is why I wonder about that last paragraph, too, how that might have sounded differently if the book had been written later. But the students were reading it, I think, through the students' eyes. And in that way, I think that they identified with all the moments when they use language that we wish maybe they
would use. What was the language? I don't even remember. Are we talking swear words? Are we talking?
I was talking more references to African Americans.
Oh, okay.
I was a little surprised when I read the book. I was not, whoa.
Mm-hmm. We were, I mean, I'll speak for myself. I was a little nervous that it, but.
I just wondered, even faculty didn't.
No. I didn't hear it. But then again, you know, like, you have to remember, like, we're in the Conroy, Mr. Conrack position, and maybe more at the beginning of his journey than we are at the end. And so, like, I don't know that the students, even especially in their first semester of their first year, would have voiced what they really, really thought. I mean, you have, I tried to account for that. I don't know. They might still be in that passage where of life where they're drawing portraits that look like me because they think that's what I want to see. And especially in a discussion group where they're maybe with 15 people they don't know very well and an adult that they don't know at all. So, I don't know.
Well, in my opinion, it's good that it was accepted as a piece of work as it was of the times, mm-hmm. as opposed to somebody making an issue with today's political stance. Mm-hmm.
I want to say something because I always get really nervous and I don't want to speak up. But I absolutely love this book, and my perspective is not from a teacher. I am a relatively new social worker, older in life. So actually, I think this final paragraph, it doesn't matter what age you was because it was a new experience. And I think the isolation for me is what really hit me because you're trying so hard to make this impact. And it's one thing to, like, not understand the culture you've walked into, even though you think you do,
yeah.
but then to have the people who are supposed to be supporting you
yeah.
disappointing you right and left.
Yeah.
And I think the bucking up even against wanting that money for the boat, I think was perfect to keep doing. But I also, you know, ended up leaving the first career that I had in social work, and you do question that. You think, gosh, if I'd have stuck it out a little more, if I had made a difference for those kids. So for me, this book was super impactful. Super impactful. And I think he was growing through the whole thing. Every painful bit of it.
Now that it's been a couple years since you did this in the first year program, have any of the students, like, come back and had time to reflect on this and talked about it?
I don't think...
Or it's still too soon for that.
I can't think of any who talked to me. I brought it in a little bit. I was teaching a first-year class called More Perfect Worlds, and we read Thomas More's Utopia, and we read part of it. And we read a book that a book of poems by Nikki Giovanni called Chasing Utopia. And I asked some of... And I'm in touch with a lot of the students. This was a particularly tight-knit... One of the sections was particularly tight-knit talked a little bit about if we could read the Fusky as a kind of utopia, like as an island, you know, that is a more perfect world in some ways. So I'm not, I haven't had conversations about the actual book with students in that class, but I'm in touch with a lot of those students. I think because some of the students were turned off by the, like, really pretty explicitly, like, social layers of our content, and some of them, it was one of the first times in which they maybe talked about some of those things in a classroom before, and so I bonded with some of them, but I don't know, actually.
Have you, Brian? Have you been?
Well, I mean, it's, you guys were talking about that sort of moment where, you know, you don't find out until much later the impact you've had. I 2 years might be too soon, but I was just asking out of curiosity since you were leading the program.
And, like, to that I would say, or maybe never, you know, like, sometimes that happens too, I think, maybe that you don't, and that's kind of one of the things, sad maybe, but also kind of joyful, that you don't really know what the story is, but you know there is one. Maybe we let Pat have the last words. I brought one of my favorite quotations. This is from an interview. So he says, he tells his students, I want you to live good, contributing lives, and our job was to grab kids and set them on fire. And I said, you can feel like this when you read books. You can feel like this when something touches you. And if you read the rest of your life, if you're touched like this for the rest of your life, you're a free man or woman the rest of your life. I love that, and I think it's very much in the spirit of The Water is Wide.
Pat's not actually here, so he doesn't get the last word. This whole notion of, you know, where are they now? What does it mean? What does it mean to reflect on it much later in life? I want to read a passage from this young woman right there who appears in the photo book y'all have. She's called Ethel in the book. Her real name is Sally Ann Robinson. I know some of you have met her, but this is a passage that she wrote about the impact of Pat's life just after he passed away, knowing that Pat would never read this, but knowing that we would. And this is how Sally Ann Robinson described her teacher, Pat Conroy. That school year was unforgettable for me. Pat was patient and generous. He made every day an adventure while teaching us about history, math, spelling, reading, music, you name it, he taught it. And all the while, he was preparing us for the wide world we were going to face once we left our island. He could take the words in a book and bring them to life for us, and we were amazed. I was a curious student, hungry for knowledge. I got up every morning wanting to go to school because this wonderful teacher would be there, could make learning fun while opening our eyes to a future we didn't know was ours. Pat taught me to be a go-getter. Get out there and get it. It's all out there for you. Education is your freedom, and know that you can do anything you want if you want it bad enough. It's very similar to the passage you just quoted as well. So that's what Pat meant to one student in particular. And watch this. This is called a segue. Oh, look. Sally Ann Robinson will be in this very room on Friday, June 7th, where she will be teaching a cooking demonstration for us. Sally Ann can't do cooking without telling stories, so it's sort of those two things together. It begins at 5:30, and it ends whenever she stops talking. And if you've ever seen Sally Ann, you know it's probably going to be longer than we've projected, but it's a really delightful experience to have, just to get to know Sally Ann, to hear stories not only about Pat, but about the island, about her family's history, about how it all relates to food in her life. She's gone on to be the author of 2 cookbooks. There's a 3rd one coming out. She was a teaching assistant for a while. Of the 18 students Pat taught, 4 of them went on to become teachers themselves in some capacity, Sally Ann being one of them. So it's a wonderful opportunity. We hope you all come back for that as well. We want to thank Mollie for leading an incredible discussion here tonight, and thank all of you for participating. It was really wonderful. thank you all so much for coming. We hope to see you back here sometime.